the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Welcome now to this celebration of the 14th Sunday in Ordinary Time here at St. Joseph on the Brandywine Church. My name is Monsignor Joseph Redman, the pastor. Father Glenn Evers is assisting me as the associate pastor. Dr. Donna Beach is at the organ. And Carol Brandt is our cantor. Brothers and sisters, it is so good to see you, whether you have been tuning in regularly, or whether this is the first time, whether you're a parishioner or a visitor, we're happy to have you joining in this visual community celebration. And in today's liturgy, my dear friends, Jesus addresses us with comforting words. He says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest." Let those words wash over us and all of our responsibilities, all the stresses that we're under, and all the failures that haunts us. "My yoke is easy," Jesus assures us. "My burden is light." So as we gather together on this holiday weekend, let us rejoice in the freedom Jesus offers us from all our heavy burdens. To prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries, we pause to acknowledge our faults and failings. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Let us pray. O God, who in the abasement of your Son have raised up a fallen world, fill your faithful people with holy joy. For on those you have rescued from the slavery to sin, you have bestowed eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Zechariah. Thus says the Lord, "Rejoice heartily, O daughter Zion. Shout for joy, O daughter Jerusalem. See, your king shall come to you. A just Savior is he, meek, and riding on an ass, on a colt the foal of an ass. He shall banish the chariot from Ephraim, and the horse from Jerusalem. The warrior's bow shall be banished, and he shall proclaim peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth." The word of the Lord. Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit, if only the Spirit of God dwells in you. Whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that that dwells in you. Consequently, brothers and sisters, we are not debtors of the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
At that time, Jesus exclaimed, "I give praise to you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for although you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, you have revealed them to little ones. Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves. For my yoke is easy, and my burden light." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I first want to congratulate those young men and women who have graduated this spring, whether they have graduated in person or virtually, whether they graduated from kindergarten or elementary school or middle school or high school or received any other advanced degrees. I want to salute you and your families who are also rejoicing as you move on to another level of academic activity, or if you move out of academic activity and are now trying to find a job. And we wish you well and assure you of our prayers. Some of you have heard this true story about a graduation. It was at a graduation ceremony at the University of Maryland a few years ago. The graduates marched in with great solemnity, as they usually do. Parents were smiling and brushing away tears at the same time. The speakers appropriately stayed within the guidelines called for by political correctness, and no one dared ask for divine blessings on the graduates or their families. The final speaker was one of the students. He went up to the podium. He stood there silently for a few minutes. And then, without a cue that was evident to everyone present, every one of the students sneezed at the same time. And the student at the podium looked at the audience and said, "God bless you. God bless you, each and every one of you." And then he walked off the stage. The audience exploded in surprise. Now, up until a few hundred years ago, the yoke spoken about in today's gospel passage was very common. This yoke was not the yoke of an egg. It was a yoke that would join two animals together, so their combined strength could pull a plow or a wagon. Now we have trucks and tractors to do the work of the animals. The word yoke was also having a symbolic meaning. It symbolized slavery and servitude. At the time of Jesus, the Jewish law, besides the civil law, which was the law of the Roman conquerors of Palestine, Israel at that time, the Jewish law, the spiritual law, sometimes was referred to as a burden, a yoke to be endured. The way the scribes and the Pharisees interpreted God's law certainly proved to be a burden to God's people. And when Jesus said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me," he was contrasting his way, his teachings, to the Jewish leaders' incorrect and burdensome interpretations of God's law that the people would hear weekly in their synagogue attendance. The spirit behind Jesus' teachings would lift their burdens, and it would be refreshing. "Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest," Jesus says. I think there are two ideas that are worth reflecting on. First, Jesus said, "My yoke is easy and my burden light." Every law, you know, is a burden. And this includes even the laws Jesus gave us, for law always involves obligations and responsibilities. Things we have to do and things we have to obey. When we obey his law, we discovered, or should discover, it is not overburdening. Rather, it will lift our spirits, for it will lead us to eternal life. Sin, which is another word for disobedience to God, puts a burden on us. St. Paul tells us, when we sin, we become indebted to sin. And we all know what debt can do for us. It weighs us down. Next week in the scriptures, Paul will tell us more about how sin can enslave us, while living according to the Spirit gives us life. The other thing about a yoke that it joins is that it joins two animals together. And with a yoke, one animal does not pull the wagon or the plow alone. So when Jesus said, "Come to me, take my yoke upon you," he is offering to be our partner in bearing our burdens. He is offering so that we won't have to go through life alone. We will have a companion. He promised at the Last Supper, you see, if you remember, he would not leave us orphans. All we need to do, and sometimes we need to do it every day, is to commit ourselves to following him, and he will be there for us each and every day. It is something that we can be assured of. Now also, in Jesus' day, the Jewish people were under Roman occupation, and there were very severe laws. And they found themselves at the mercy of the Roman soldiers. They had to pay heavy taxes, but they had no say in how the taxes were set upon them. They had no say in how the Roman Empire operated. The Jews dragged with them their lack of freedom everywhere they went. And Jesus could not offer the kind of political freedom that they wanted. Jesus, you see, did not lead an army to defeat the Romans. Jesus offered rest as spiritual energy. Jesus offered rest as refreshment for the soul. Jesus offered rest as assurance that God cares about them. Jesus offered rest as the promise of resurrection. Now today in the United States, we do not deal with the burden of occupation by a stranger nation. We do have the occupation of a disease that is traversing the whole world and our own nation. And we often feel frustrated by the political divisions in our country. We may feel the anger and the venom in our country as a burden. We may feel weary of the fighting and the lack of cooperation. We may feel confused about social issues and arguments that they create. We may feel a burden looking at the suffering of the poor, of the starving children in our own country, at the Mexican border, and in the third world outside of our borders. God calls us to do what we can, both domestically and in foreign lands. But the burden, as you well know, can feel at times overwhelming. What can I, one person, really do? Besides politics and social issues, we find other ways that life can weigh us down. We experience grief as a burden. During these last 4 months, many families have experienced the loss of a loved one, and they suffer because they have not been able to give them a proper departure celebration from this life. We can feel heavy burden with sorrow. If we have health problems, they can weigh us down. If we struggle with a lack of money, that can become a heavy burden. If we struggle with job employment or job cutback, that indeed can be something trying for ourselves individually or for our family. Young people coming out of college do not have a place to work. They have to move back in with mommy and daddy. And sometimes mommy or daddy also have lost a job or had a cutback. So it affects the way in which the family can operate. But friends, Jesus will not take all our burdens away from us. Jesus did not end Roman occupation for the Jewish people of his day. So Jesus does not always change our outward circumstances. Jesus gives us the resources to keep going. Jesus teaches us that our burdens are not God's will for us, but rather they are struggles through which God builds our integrity. Jesus even redeems the burdens that seem so awful we cannot see what we should learn from them. Jesus' promise of resurrection sustains us even in the deepest of our struggles. Jesus heals the pain in our souls so that we don't feel crushed by the heavy burdens. Jesus takes our struggles and folds them into the kingdom of heaven so that everything we do has meaning. We trade the yokes that seem to hold us back for Jesus' yoke that redeems our efforts. And with Jesus' yoke, our struggles build character and courage. With Jesus' yoke, our smallest efforts become part of God's new creation. With Jesus' yoke, we in the church pull together, sharing the load and sustaining each other. So do our heads and our hearts seem to pull us in different directions at times? Does trying to understand the mystery of the Trinity confuse us? Jesus assures us here that we can accept God's grace even if we don't understand it. Even infants can receive God's grace. So, my friends, rejoice in God's revelation and the intellect God gives us to try to push deeper into our appreciation of it. And we rejoice also that we can take our burdens to Jesus, who offers us rest. We accept the refreshment and the strength and the comfort that Jesus offers us. It is there for our taking 24 hours a day. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, and I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now, if you were in church, we would now be having the prayer of the faithful. So we now stand. We can remember at home when you're attending the visual mass, you can also do the actions that you would do if you were in church. So feel free to stand up and take a break, if you want to call it that, so that you can offer your prayers to the Lord in an erect position. We have all gathered here, dear brothers and sisters, to celebrate the mysteries of our redemption. Let us therefore ask Almighty God that the whole world may be watered from these wellsprings of all blessing and life.
Let the Holy Spirit foster in the church on earth, bringing minds closer in thought and opening hearts to new possibilities through the unity of our Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That young people may consider a vocation to the religious life, enriching our church by the talents and gifts they bring to enliven our faith community. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those gathered at this table find the true meaning of freedom and service and sacrifice to others. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may appreciate the many blessings we have been given and pray for peace, justice, and equality in our land, especially this week as we celebrate Independence Day. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the Lord may bless and keep safe all of our families and friends who are traveling during these summer days. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We also pray for an end to the COVID-19 virus and pray that the Lord blesses and helps all those affected by it. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all of the faithful departed, all of those who have gone before us, especially for Lawrence and Sullivan, for whom this Mass is offered, that they all might enjoy the splendor of heaven. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And finally, we pray for all of those intentions which we hold in the silence of our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. May the petitions of your church be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, so that we may receive from your mercy what we cannot ask out of confidence in our own merits. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now I want to take a moment to thank you for your donations that have been coming in each week to help support our parish during this time of crisis. We have not been getting as much as we usually get in our collections, but we do appreciate those who have been sending in their offerings or dropping them off in the drop box by the rectory front door, and also those who are contributing through the diocesan website, where they can contribute directly to our diocese. Those donations have been coming in, and they have been credited to your accounts. We also thank those who have been having their offerings sent through their respective banks. They too have been coming in, and be assured that they are noted and filed accordingly. And so we also thank you for keeping up your offering to the annual Catholic Appeal. Our diocese is not as doing as well as we would think it would be doing at this time. Nevertheless, we are gratified by the contributions being made to the annual Catholic Appeal. Brothers, sisters, pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Heavenly Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
May this oblation dedicated to your name purify us, O Lord, and day by day bring our conduct closer to the life of heaven through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live, we move, we have our being. And while in this body, we do not experience the daily effects of your care, but even now we possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with angels and archangels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion of bread, he blessed it, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more, giving thanks, gave the chalice to his disciples and said, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and the eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Francis, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. May praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Command informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Grant, we pray, O Lord, that having been replenished by such great gifts that you have given us, we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We hope you are keeping up to date with the various activities of the parish. There are not that many activities because of the sheltering we're supposed to do. But we do want you to remember to look at the website, and you'll see the parish bulletin comes up every week, and it tells you the many things that are going on. It tells you about the fact that we now have, besides the 10:30 Mass on Sunday, we also have a 7:30 in the morning on Sunday. And we also have a daily Mass in the week now, our usual daily Mass at 7 o'clock. And we invite those who are able to take advantage of these opportunities. We understand that many who shelter at home because of their age, our infirmities, and so they're excused from coming. But in the past few Sundays, we average attendance at Sunday Mass in about 70 people. And they are full of excitement and joy as they come. Of course, they have to be masked and they have to sit 6 feet apart, but they're adjusting to that. Also, I want to bring to your attention, which is not in the bulletin this week, but it will be next week, the fact that we're going to collect items again for Syrian refugees. This will be done by an ecumenical organization called the Narang of Tree Foundation.org. And they've been sending containers of previously used, or I say gently used, clothes and scarves, pillowcases, walkers, wheelchairs, health items, aspirins, Tylenol, and Phenamin products, bars of soap, etc. Anything else that would please children, particularly toys. And we're just giving you this information now so you can start. We have a little more time during the summertime to clean out some of your closets. And on the weekend of the 25th and 26th, Saturday the 25th from 12 to 6, Sunday, July the 26th from 9 to 1, we'll have a small trailer parked over alongside the archive building. Between the archive building and the garage, where you can bring those things at the time. So keep watching the website, and you'll find the article that I'm announcing today. And I'm just giving it to you now, so you can make preparation for that by getting out some of the things in your closets that you feel would help other people in need. They've been doing this for 13 years now, and they've sent over 60 containers of household goods to our brothers and sisters, Christians and non-Christians, who are refugees in the country of Syria. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Graciously enlighten your family, O Lord, we pray, that by holding fast to what is pleasing to you, they may be worthy to accomplish all that is good through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you all, remain with you forever.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.